When Solomon was a little boy, angel came to him and said, what would you like? What would you like in your life? Would you like to be famous? Would you like to be rich? Would you like to be powerful? And Solomon replied, what I would like is wisdom. And as a little boy, it struck me, I thought, if that angel had come to me, asked me the same question, offered me the same gift, what would I have said? And I said, I would like to learn to see. Because seeing to me is a mystery. How do we see? I didn't quite know what the mystery was, but there was a mystery. I know that there's a difference between hearing and listening. But I couldn't quite figure out the difference between looking and seeing. Eventually it came to me that the difference between looking and seeing is a matter of paying attention. So seeing is not just optics. Optics is what comes into the eye. Seeing is what we attend to. Like I remember the old Superman comics where Superman looked at something, it was a dotted line. He's now looking at that, and his eyes could actually burn a hole in the wall. His vision is an X-ray vision, they call it in those days. Today it would be laser vision, I suppose. So that's the way I see. I see, I don't have the light hitting the ball and then coming to my eye and my eye is a neutral receptor. No, I look at the ball. My vision is directed. Seeing is something that I choose to do. I choose what I want to see. I look up and down and I look from side to side. That's my seeing. Seeing is an act, an action. So seeing is not optics. Seeing is the play of attention. Seeing is paying attention. And attention is love. When we say that the child needs attention and we say that the child needs love, it's the same thing. We cannot say, here you are, let me give you some love, my child. All we can do is listen to the child, talk to the child, smile at the child. You know, pay attention to the child. And that is what the child needs and requires. That is love. As a child, I drew from imagination. That was art to me. That was life. That was the beauty. That was my passion. Everything I drew was from imagination. Not even from copying a flower, a real flower. That felt weird to me. But the idea of copying a photograph was like sacrilege to me. Why would anybody do that? You're given this gift by God. And now you say, no, I don't want that. I would rather copy this stuff. I would rather look like I'm very, 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 very smart. You know that throughout the history of art, all the great artists, Michelangelo, Rodin, Leonardo da Vinci, Raphael, Titian, Tintoretto, the whole lot of them, Rembrandt even, and Degas, and particularly Cezanne, they all battled to get their proportions right, and in most cases they had some spectacular failures. But now, in the 20th century and in the 21st century, we have a plethora of artists. The maximum, most artists can give you perfect proportions. They can give you all the lines around the eyes and the individual little bits of beard. They draw better than Michelangelo, they draw and paint better than Rembrandt. Why? Because they're tracing photographs. Vision is not optics. Vision is the vision of the seers, the vision of the saints, the vision of Mozart, the vision of Beethoven, who actually said once, that I have never composed anything that I have not seen. Vision is love, vision is care, vision is celebration. Seeing then is a form of love. And drawing a sparrow from a photograph is absent of love. But drawing a sparrow in nature, or even just sitting outside and looking at the sparrow and enjoying it, and celebrating it, making the music of the sparrow, the flutter of the sparrow, the dance of the sparrow, all of those things That is love, and that is art. So we can see in many different ways, physically, to make our art possible. First way that we see is line. When we draw a line, we actually move our eyes around the subject like that. Right across the body, across the outlines of the hips, so up around the face, around the eyes. All the details, the line is moving. So a line is drawn through space and a line is drawn on paper. Those two lines become one line. A separate way of seeing is when we look at color. When we look at color, we're doing comparisons all the time. Comparing this color here to this color here. A little bit lighter, a little bit more bluish. To this color here, a little bit of a middle tone, a little bit of brown into it, and that color there. Pale, gold, amber. So that's how we see color. A lot like pixels on a computer screen. And then for tonality, we have a different way of seeing. Again, we see too many tones. Our eyes perceive too many tones optically. So we divide them into two. We divide them into a province of light and a province of dark. We do that by half closing our eyes. And when we half close our eyes, only the lightest bits remain. And we mark them out, we map them out. And that gives us a very good clue for what we're doing in our drawing and in our paintings. Vision is not optics. If you are colorblind, you have nothing to worry about because you see perfectly well. You see as the eagle sees in light and dark. If you are night blind, you see perfectly well because you see as the butterfly sees. And your color vision is higher than those of people who are not night blind. You have a better color vision than that. If, God forbid, you should ever go completely blind, lose your sight completely, you still have nothing to worry about because you see with your eyes, you see with your heart, not with your eyes. You see with your heart and you see with your love. And that is the way that artists see, the imagination, the memory, the visualization, making things happen and move. That is the way movie makers and writers and musicians and things, visualizing the thing and constructing it. That is what's happening. And that is the artist. As the custodians of beauty and of truth, we are the earth's last